Hello, my dear students. Take the stones that people throws at you. Use the same stone to construct the momentum for you. My dear students, let me start a beautiful, important chapter for all of you in today's session, that is constructors and destructors. This is one of the important chapters that all of you should understand really well. Let's start with the blueprint. So you have the prescribed hours for this chapter is 8 hours, and you will get 1 2-marks question from this chapter and 1 5-marks question. In total, you will get 7 marks from this chapter. My dear students, easily you can score 7 marks. You will have to attend only 2 questions. One is 2 marks, 1 question, and 7 marks, 1 question. Let's take a bird's eye view. What is that I will study in this chapter? So my dear students, the first thing that I will understand is, what is constructor and why should I need to study the constructor? That is what I will call it as a need of constructors. What is the second point that I will read? So how many types of constructors that I have? So is what I will be discussing in this chapter. And the next one that I will study is implicit and explicit declaration of constructors. My dear students, this is one of the important topic in this chapter. And the next one is constructor overloading. We have already studied the function overloading. A little slight change in the concept, that is what you will understand, that is constructor overloading. And the next and the last topic that you are going to study is destructors. So these are the important topics that you will study in this chapter. If you understand all this chapter, so you will score 7 marks easily. So it will be in your pocket completely, my dear students. Let's start with the basic concepts of constructor. So my dear students, the first point that you need to understand, so whenever you are taking any constructor, please understand the constructor name. The constructor name is always same as a class name. My dear students, you need to understand this point. The constructor name will be same as the class name. That is the first point that you should remember. So whatever the point that I am discussing right now, please make a mark of it. I will take a program to explain all this points with the example of program. My dear students, what is the first point that I started with? So the constructor name should be same as class name. That should be the first point that you should remember. What is the second point that I have? So it will not have any return type. So please remember, I'm speaking with respect to the functions. So function should be a constructor. When the function will be a constructor, when the name of the function and the name of the class is same, then I will call that function as a constructor. I will repeat, my dear students, what I will call it as a constructor? When my function name and the class name is same, when the function name and the class name is same, then I will call that function as a constructor. Remember, the constructor will not have any return type. For example, imagine I have a class. So imagine I have a class ABC. My class name is ABC. And inside this class, imagine I have public. Okay, I have public access specifier. My function name, what should be my function name according to the first point? My function name should be ABC. Sir, why are you taking the name of this function as ABC? Because only when my function name and the class name is same, then only I will treat this function as constructor. Point number one. Point number two, my dear students, whenever we are taking any other functions, we used to write the return type here. It could be int, or it could be void, or it could be double, but we are not writing any return type for the constructor. My dear students, that is what you need to remember with respect to the second point. What is the third point that I have? Make sure that you will declare that constructor under the scope of public. You will declare the constructor under the scope of public. What is the meaning of it, sir? So always your constructor should be under the scope of public. You cannot declare it under the scope of private or under the scope of protected. So 3 points. Constructor name should be same as class name. Second point, it should not have any return type. Third point, always you should declare it under the scope of public. So this is the 3 points that you should know with respect to the constructor. By saying all these things, by now you would have got some idea about constructor. Why do I need this constructor, sir? So my dear students, if you want to initialize the values, automatically you will be using the constructor. I will repeat, if you want to initialize the values automatically, you will use the constructor. So now you understood the definition of it. My question to all of you is, sir, why do we need this constructor? By explaining all these 3 points, you would have got some idea. But now can you tell us, why do we need this constructors? My dear students, I'll take a small story for all of you. Imagine I am writing a program. In that program, I have to initialize many variables. For example, I have declared around 10 to 12 variables. Suppose, imagine I forgot to initialize some variables. I will repeat, I have declared many variables like int a comma b comma c comma so on. I have declared multiple variables in my program, my dear students, but I forgot to initialize the values for that variables. What happens when you don't initialize the values? So automatically the garbage value will be stored inside the variables. When you execute the same program, what happens? You will not get the accurate result because the variable contains the garbage value. So to avoid this problem, I am giving the responsibility to the compiler to initialize the variables automatically whenever the object is created. I will repeat. So being a human being, my dear students, we have a tendency to forget a lot of things. Yes or no? Yes. If we forget to initialize the variables, the garbage value will be stored inside the variables. So what happens if I calculate something with a garbage value? I will end up in getting the result as garbage value. To avoid this problem, I'm giving the responsibility to the compiler to initialize the value to the variable. So who is doing that? So constructor is taking the responsibility to initialize the values to the variable whenever the object is created. That is the point that you should understand with respect to the constructor. So this is what the constructor is doing for me in my programming language. So after understanding this point, you need to recollect all these points. So I understood I need a constructor to initialize the values. Now how do I create the constructor? Yes. So after that, you need to understand these 3 points. So hope you got the concept that why do I need constructor. Moving on to the next points with respect to the constructors, my dear students, what is the next point that I have? Constructor is invoked automatically whenever the object is created. My dear students, if you ask me who will call the constructor, you don't have to call the constructor, my dear students. If you create the object for that particular class, automatically that constructor will be called. Automatically the constructor will be called. That is what you need to remember. Constructor can have default arguments. I will be speaking with respect to the arguments whenever I'm taking the different types of constructor. So as of now, you need to understand, even constructor also can take the default arguments, my dear students. The last point, very very important point. So the constructor will be using two keywords. What is the first one that I have? New and delete. If you want to allocate the memory, I will be using this new, and if I want to delete or deallocate the memory, I will be using the delete. So that is what you need to remember as of now with respect to the constructor. So my dear students, this is the concepts that you need to understand with respect to the constructor. Let me explain this concept with respect to a program. Let's take a program. So my dear students, so you all know that this is the header files. Let me not explain this header files again. So what is the first one that I have? I have a keyword called class. All of you know that I should start with a keyword called class. Then what is the name of the class? So my name of the class is counter. So inside that I have the access specifier private. In that I have created a variable a of type int. I have created a variable of type int. My dear students, after that you need to observe a little carefully. So my dear students, this is the important part of my explanation. I have the access specifier. I have the access specifier public. Point number one that you should remember. So what is the access specifier that I have? Public. Inside that, so you should treat this as function. I have already told you, if you come across with a parenthesis, you should treat that as a function. Yes. What is the name of the function here? Can you observe? The name of the function is counter, and the name of the classes counter. Whenever the function name as well as the class name is same, then you should treat this function as constructor. That is the first point that you should remember. The second point that you should remember is it should be under the scope of public. It should be under the scope of public, my dear students. And the point number three, my dear students, please don't forget the point number three. I don't have any return type here. I should have given void, int, or double, or some other return type I should have given here. But for constructor, I should not have any return type. That is the next point that you should remember with respect to the constructor. This is the three important points that you should remember. So what is happening inside? My dear students, I am initializing the value of a. Whenever I call this constructor, what will happen? The initialization of variables will happen. So what is the variable that I have? I have a. So I am initializing the value of a. When I am initializing it? So my dear students, that is what I will explain in the coming steps. Please stay tuned. So here in the constructor, I am initializing the value of a. So that is the job of this constructor that I am performing here in this program. After that, I will close the function. Then I will go to the next function. So what is this void? Void is a return type. By knowing this, you will understand this is the normal function that I have, which is declared inside the class. Yes, void is a return type, and the name of the function is increment count. My dear students, please make a note. So what is that I'm performing here? I'm performing increment of a value. Increment of a value in the sense what? A plus plus in the sense what? A plus 1. Whatever the value of a that I have, so it will be incremented by 1. Okay, that is what you need to remember. Suppose if I have 0, so it will be incremented to 1. Suppose if I have 1, so it will be incremented to 2. So like that, it will be incremented by 1 by performing this operation. That is what you need to remember, my dear students, with respect to this function. What is this function is performing? This, if I call this function, so it will increment the value of a by 1. That is what you need to understand. After this, I have one more function followed by this. My dear students, what is the return type of this? The return type of this is int. What is the meaning of int? If I have my return type as int, so it will return some value. What is the value it is returning? So it is returning the a value. What is the meaning of void? Suppose if I have my return type as void, it will not return any value. That is what you need to understand, my dear students. Am I returning anything? No, I'm not returning anything. How will I come to know, sir, whether it is returning or not? Do I have the keyword written? Here I have. Do I have here? No, I don't have. So it means it is not returning any value. That is what you need to understand. My dear students, here I have int. So obviously I should have the keyword return. So it means what? It is returning the value of a to outside the program. That is what you need to remember. Or it can also return the value to the inside. So that is what you need to remember. My dear students, what is the meaning of return? So you need to understand, if I have the keyword return, then you need to understand that it is returning the value of a. That is what you need to remember. So after that, I will close this class. So my dear students, my main function will start here. Always remember, your program execution always starts from the main function, my dear students. Always remember, my first line to get executed from this, not from this. You need to understand this. My main function execution starts from here. What is that we have? My dear students, please understand, I have counter. What is the meaning of counter here? Please understand, what is the meaning of counter? So counter is the name of the class. What is this C1 and C2? C1 and C2, my dear students, that is the object names. that I have. How many objects I have? I have two objects. What is the first object? So first object is C1, second object is C2. What is the meaning of the C1 and C2, sir? If you ask me, C1 is one copy of this entire class, C2 is another copy of this entire class. That is the meaning of it. You need to understand, C1 is an entire copy of this class, C2 is also one entire copy of the same class, my dear students. So that is what I'm trying to do here. Then after that, C out. What is that I'm trying to print now? My dear students, C1, object 1, that is C1 is trying to call get count. C1 is trying to call get count. So what is the function get count? Where do I have? So get count is here. Get count is here, my dear students. So why do I call this function? To just print the value of A as of now, before performing any operation, what is the value of A with respect to C1? So what is the value of A right now? The value of A right now is 0. As soon as you create C1 and C2, automatically the value of A will get initialized to 0. That is the point that you should remember. So if I print the value of A using this function call, so you need to understand that what is the value of A right now? The value of A is 0 because I have not performed anything. In the same way, please listen carefully. Now C2.getCount, in the sense, second object is calling this function. If I call this function, it will return the value of A. What is the value of A? The value of A is 0. The value of A is 0. So it will print for both C1 and C2, the value of A will be 0. The value of A will be 0. You need to understand now. So my dear students, C1 is calling increment count. C1 is calling increment count. Which is the increment count here? So my dear students, this is increment count. This function is called by C1. This function is called by C1. So what is the value of A right now? Right now the value of A is 0. After calling this function, what will be my value of A? My value of A will become 1. My value of A will become 1. So after calling this statement, that is what you need to understand. So after that, please observe. So after that, C2 will call the same function. You need to understand this. C2's A, what is the value? C2's A is, again it is 0. After calling this statement, again it will become 1. Again it will become 1. Sir, why? It is already 1, right? So my dear students, you need to understand this concept. So A is different for C1, A is different for C2. Individually we are performing the operations. That is what you need to understand. So right now, before performing this operation, C2 value is 0. After I call the statement, my value of A will become 1. Right now, this is for C1, this is for C2. The value of A will be 1. So again, what is the next statement that I have? I have the same statement. Again, one more time I will call this one. So what will happen? So my dear students, again the increment will happen. Right now my A value is 1. Again, if I call the increment operator, A value will become plus 1. So plus 1, in the sense, what will be the A value? A value is 2 for C2. A value is 2 for C2. That is what you need to remember. After executing this statement, what is the next statement that I have? I'm just trying to print the A value with respect to C1. So how do I print? So my dear students, same step I will perform. C1.getCount. So which function will be called? This function will be called. What is this function is doing? It is just returning the A value. So what is the A value of C1? So you need to understand, A value of C1 is 1. So 1 will be printed. And the next statement you need to understand, my dear students, again, C2 will call the same function. What is the A value of C2? My dear students, you need to understand this. A value of C2 is 2. So 2 will be printed. So by printing it, so I will close the bracket. So this is the end of the program. By understanding all these things, what is the main thing that you need to understand? What is that I should get from this program, sir, with respect to constructor? Please highlight that. My dear students, please remember, I will repeat it one more time for all of you. Point number one. So this is what you need to remember. What is the name of the class and what is the name of the function name? So class name and the function name should be same. Point number one. Point number two, always that you should declare this function under the scope of public, then only you will call it as a constructor. That is a point number two. And point number three, no return type. Point number three, there is no return type. So what happens inside the constructor, my dear students? This is what the initialization will happen inside the constructor. Initialization will happen inside the constructor. When the initialization will happen, my dear students, as soon as you initialize the objects, as soon as you create the objects, initialization will happen automatically. These 5 points you need to remember how exactly this constructor is working. This is the important points that you should understand, my dear students, with respect to this program. Let us understand how many different types of constructors do we have. So my dear students, we have 3 types of constructor, 1, 2, and 3. The first one is default constructor. What is the first one that we have? It is a default constructor. What is the second one that we have? That is a parameterized constructor. The second type of constructor that we have is parameterized constructor, and the last one is copy constructor. So my dear students, I will be discussing in detail about this types of constructors, but I have already discussed the default constructor already, so you will understand what is default constructor if you watch my next session completely. So till then, take care. Bye bye.